We are about to have a talk from the lovely Heather Kelley, who's standing here being Heather Kelley. She is a super exciting games person. She is a professor at Carnegie Mellon University. She's an artist, a curator, an experimental game designer. And as well as being part of the super cool Coco Romy, she also runs an experimental games event called Gamma. She's going to introduce you to herself, and she has some other performers involved in this talk as well. And we're going to have a super great Q&A at the end, so I hope you're as stoked as I am. Show me your stoked faces. Woo! Yes, thank you. Okay, so without further ado, I want to give a big round of applause to Heather Kelley and You Construct Intricate Rituals.
Thanks so much. Yes. The subtitle of this is maybe the new thing, Somatics in Game Design. So has anyone here heard of somatics before, that word? One or two people, maybe? Okay. I'll talk more about what it actually is, so if you don't know, don't worry about it. But roughly, it's like thinking and studying the subjective experience of how you feel in your body, what it feels like to be a physical entity and alive and moving. So I'll get into that. But the idea for this talk is some thinking I've been doing only really quite recently about this topic, so you'll see it's a bit of a kind of exploratory thing for me as well. I don't think anyone has yet written or created some work around this idea of the psychology and phenomenology of the body and game design. I could be wrong. Please do tell me if I am, because I would love to hear what else had been going on. I mean, but the interesting thing for designers is that we create activity and interactivity between people and objects, and we care about people's emotions. So, I mean, I think it makes perfect sense that we should care about how players actually literally feel physically when they're playing our games, and also like what larger effects that might have. Next slide. I have to say next slide. So a little bit about me first, for those who may not have heard anything about me. I'm going to just talk about a few very highlight projects. This is Super Hypercube. It was created by my collective, Coco Romy. You mentioned Gamma, the event that we organized. We first started running Gamma in 2006, and we're a collective of four people. We decided at the time in Montreal we wanted to bring experimental gameplay to a larger audience, so we put on these events and asked people to create games around a specific topic or sort of interface technology, and we did one that was red and blue 3D glasses. So everyone in the that came to the event got those glasses, and all the games used this stereoscopic vision to like try out different ways of does 3D even really matter? Like, does three-dimensional vision matter in games? We kind of found out that it didn't until you do things like adding head tracking. And so we had a game, Super Hypercube, the original version, that used the Wiimote sensor as a hacked together 3D or head tracking motion detection. And so when the latest round of VR came along, we realized, and we'd been asked over and over again, hey, could you release this game? But there was never really a good way to do that until, say, Oculus and Rift and things, Oculus and Vive started coming along. So this is actually the game as it exists now. When we brought it to VR, we were able to definitely add a lot more color, and we're like heavily influenced by light and space artists and by like the imaginary vision of what VR was going to be back in the 70s, 80s, 90s, and so it's on PlayStation and will be coming to Vive pretty soon. Next slide. My other practice, aside from like straight up video games, is I have a much more physical games-based practice. This is a piece called Train pas entre terre et ciel, and it is a 19-meter-long hopscotch for two people. It's like a pas de deux that I created with Them Games. We have Oscar here in the audience today, who made it with me, and the idea is that the whole thing has to be played with two people, and there's a lot of instructions along the hopscotch that tell you what you need to do at any given moment. And as you can see from the shapes of squares. They're facing in different directions to sort of tell you which way you need to aim. And the instructions are usually something to do with how you interact with the other person, like you're either holding hands or you have to hop and pass really close to one another without touching. And you can do that for the whole 19-meter length of it, and that meant that multiple people would be on it at the same time, which we learned in playtesting. So one of the really delightful things is that one of the instructions is to encourage the other hoppers that are before you on after you've almost gotten to the end to help them along. And so that's kind of what you see here. Next. So this is a piece called Oh My Bod. The original title was Body Heat, but then it was made for a piece of hardware that was developed by a company called Oh My Bod, and they liked it enough and they purchased it. It's a vibrator controller, so it's the touchscreen of the iPad is a kind of heat map, sensual interface that controls the speed and the intensity of a connected, like, vibrator, sex toy. And so that was, I guess, one of the more notorious projects that I worked on. But it's actually a very, like, the important thing for me is that the interface itself is really sensual, too. So next slide. I think we'll hear why that project is particularly relevant coming up. So this is the part of the talk where, even if it's a little early in the talk, it's probably been a long day for a lot of people, where we like do a few like little stretches and like turn our head and follow these diagrams and do our, especially do our wrists like this. So personally, my background is that when I was growing up, I was doing a lot of physical things, like the usual stuff that kids do, playing on the playground, but also swimming and dance lessons and going, like, doing theatrical stuff. And then that has kind of continued into my current life with dancing and doing yoga and bicycling and these kinds of activities. But yes, good. Thank you. Most of us probably in this room, including me, spend our actual working hours and quite a lot of our entertainment hours sitting in a chair and either at a computer screen or with a TV and holding a controller. And so I want to ask, like, how many here in this room have actually at one point or another, maybe yesterday, used a computer to the point where they were actually physically injured or in pain? Oh, come on, that's like one hand, all right. Maybe, okay, if you haven't, I'm like really happy to hear that, but I've heard it and seen it happen to like so many of my friends with a repetitive stress injury, needing physical therapy, or are currently just not dealing with it and are in pain and wearing wrist braces or using weird creams or things like that. And that's always kind of been troubling for me, and I feel like a more physically aware design practice in general could let us sort of head this off at the pass and sense these problems before they damage us. So that's also like kind of where I came to wanting to be interested in this, because it's not just for the players of the things that I want to make, it's also for the creators. Next slide. And water. Yeah, so what is somatics, this word I brought up earlier? It's as I mentioned, well, this is like your standard Wikipedia definition. Bodywork, movement studies, it's about the internal physical perception. It's about, like, in terms of, say, the dance world, this particular slide is a image from a like outdoor workshop in a movement language called Gaga. Which is very somatically influenced. And by way of example, the people that do or practice this particular dance practice aren't really paying attention to, it's not for what you look like, and it's not even for what you look like to yourself, so it's almost always done in places where there are no mirrors. And if there are mirrors, they're usually covered up because it's supposed to be about the experience you feel on the inside and getting verbal descriptions and then acting them out in a physical way, but not really caring about what other people are doing. So that's kind of one of the ways that some people interested in somatics have brought it into the dance world. And it's also, I think, important to note that it is it's against the idea of a mind-body dualism. So it's not like your body is, your mind is trapped in your body, or your body is being controlled by your mind, because they're not in conflict. It's like your mind is your body. They're working together. And then maybe the last corollary that seems especially interesting to me is that it's our internal states and our emotions are expressed physically, sometimes in very obvious ways. Like, you know, I'm not talking necessarily about like you are happy so you smile, but also just the way you walk or things like that. And then the reverse is true in that if you change your physical motion, you can change, it can help to change your internal state of mind as well. Next. So getting on to where the crazy title of this talk came from, it's a piece by Barbara Kruger from 1981. It's called Untitled, but the subtitle is You Construct Intricate Rituals. And yeah, you construct intricate rituals which allow you to touch the skin of other men. And it's always really, this one really stuck with me from the first time I saw it. And it's just feels so true. And it's, as far as I understand it, it's, of course, you know, culture creates these taboos, but we always find these ways to get around it, to get what you need. And in terms of Western culture, there's a quite, you know, a strong homophobic taboo against friendly, non-sexual touch between men, and that roughhousing and maybe sports are kind of also implicated here as a way to escape that and actually get the human contact that we all need. And of course, you know, this may be true, but what does this have to do with games and with us as creators of games? And to me, it's because games are rituals, and in the positive way, we can make that. I mean, Kruger is being very critical of this taboo and the fact that it needs to be broken with a totally different ritual. But we can turn it around, and instead of having to have these impromptu rituals that are more aggressive, we can also create rituals that are more connective or healing. So, and sorry for the really low-res picture. It was really hard to find one of these. But if you want to plug your ears, if you haven't seen the OA and don't want any spoilers, then you can do that now. But this is a scene from a recent Netflix TV show called The OA, which I thought was really interesting because I was already thinking about this work in somatics and in ritual like for maybe a few months, and then this show came on, and essentially one of the major elements of the story is that a group of people have to discover and perform very precisely a kind of ritualistic modern dance. And it to me really exemplifies like this idea that the rituals are engaging our body and our senses. They're like sequences of particular symbolic actions and interactions in a certain order, and they have a meaning. And so having this come up at the same time I'm thinking about it lets me know that there's kind of a zeitgeist going on. I think we're all sort of looking for ways to reconnect to the real world and the physical world, not through digital mediation, but in person. Okay, next slide. Thanks. I like lost my place on my alternate universe screen here. All right. Okay, yes, the fever. So, and since we're designers, we can decide what rituals communicate. We don't have to just fall into them accidentally out of just pure animal or social necessity. And because we can design them, we can actually communicate things to players through this absolutely subjective experience that they're going to have of movement when they're playing our games. So we can say things and have them become embodied in the player, and we can change people's physical awareness of their own selves. And I don't think that there are other media that can do that, but most passive or observed media, they're not really capable of doing that. So I think we have a big responsibility to think about how to facilitate this, because I think we're doing it anyway. It's just that we're not thinking about the effect it might have. So how can we do it safely so that we create things that help people instead of breaking them? And there's so many different practices in other fields that we can learn from and combine efforts with, and perhaps that way also reach people that might not already be interested in games. And one example is this piece. It's called The Fever. It's a theater piece that was debuted recently at a festival in New York. And in that picture, you can't really tell who is one of the performers and who's one of the audience members. And I went to go see this piece not knowing what it was. And at the beginning, everyone's sitting around in a kind of a circle, but it's a square theater. And people in the audience suddenly start doing certain movements, and then other people around them start copying the movements, and then other people in the audience start speaking and telling other audience members to do things, and like the whole thing is like you don't know who is part of the theater company until well into the production, and they do a very good job of not seeming to be an actor until they sort of step out and show who they are. But the way that they staged it really encouraged you. It was very much like a an onboarding for acting in front of a bunch of other people that you don't know by making small requests and then sort of upping the ante and getting people moving around in a much broader way or doing a specific gesture like helping someone up from the floor or something like that. But by near the end of the presentation, near the end of the theater piece, everybody in the entire audience that had the capability was up and like working or doing something very, very ritualistic, in fact, at moments. But it just felt very natural to be drawn into it from the very slow way that they introduced that. So that's one place I found a lot of inspiration. And here's some more. So I was talking to some other dancers that were teaching a workshop and asked them if what they had that inspired them, anything about somatics. And they brought up this book by Bonnie Bainbridge Cohen. Bonnie Bainbridge Cohen started her career as a physical and occupational therapist. But then got very dissatisfied with the limited way that people in the field were working at the time, and got it back, and branched out into much more of her own specific area of research that she ended up naming body-mind centering, which has been used in a lot of different areas like dance, bodywork, physical therapy, psychotherapy, art, meditation, athletics. But it's about like patterns of movement. So studying human movement, whether it be walking or doing some kind of work or reaching for something, and looking at it in terms of development from infancy all the way to adulthood. And part of her theory is that like things that you different processes that you were supposed to go through as a child, some people didn't get a chance to and had to kind of relearn how to do that. So my main takeaway from everything that I've read of hers so far, and there's a lot, so I've read a tiny fraction, but it's that people get stuck in certain physical behaviors that they just had to because of the way their like body is designed or by the way that they grew up, and then that keeps them stuck in certain mental patterns as well, and that it's better for them both psychologically and physically, just in terms of mechanics of how they move, to notice that and help them change that. And then another inspiration is Augusto Boal, which maybe more of you have heard of before, although never as many people as I hope or expect, who was a writer and theater director that had a kind of philosophy of liberatory political action, and later on in his career, kind of a social healing through theater with people on the street, and also doing a lot of improv and certain kinds of games, and I find that to like be one of the other kind of inspirational sources. And then maybe the one that everybody will hopefully have heard of, and if you haven't, go find out, are the New Games Movement and the New Games Foundation from Bernie DeKoven, who this was a movement that started, I think, I want to say in the 70s, maybe slightly earlier, that brought people from all different walks of life into these much more participatory and kind of childlike, silly games that just sort of break people out of their usual shells of adult behavior. And the this one is called, oh, thanks, if I hadn't switched the slide, I apologize. This one is called The Lap Game. I don't know, maybe you, some of you have played it because it's something that we end up playing more and more kids. But I found this quote that Bernie wrote about the lap game that I really thought was charming. It's like, we put each other in each other's hands and on each other's laps. We let go enough to let the person behind us take care of us, take responsibility for our safety, while we, at the same time, try to focus all our attention on the person in front of us, whom we are trying, lovingly, to guide to our knees, calmly, to leave themselves in our caring hands. So like you get a sense of that, of how kind of circular it is, because at the same time, the whole thing is like you stand very tightly in a circle, and then everyone simultaneously sits down, so you're like forming a lap at the same time as you're sitting on the person's lap behind you. So and of course, Bernie is still active, and all of these games, he does lots of workshops, and if you have a chance to go to one, definitely participate in that. And I think all these practices are really fascinating, but I'm a game developer, so like part of me is wanting to bring technology into it somehow, but not in a way that just gets us back to the same problem of, you know, ruining our bodies and keeping everything on a screen. I'm trying to get away from the screens. So the question I ask for myself is like, how do we adapt these physical practices for different audiences, new audiences, or toward our own aesthetic intentions, and still integrate the digital and electronic media if we want to. So not replacing things like this, but blending the spirit of this and the sort of good of this with technology. 10 minutes. Oh no, oh no. Wow, okay. All right, I'm gonna have to go a little quicker then, but maybe everybody knows the example of Game Oven and the wonderful work they do, and like I'm very sad that they're gone, but I know that Adrian and everybody else involved is gonna continue doing amazing stuff. Three of their games, Friendstrap, Fingal, did somebody say yep? I don't know. Yes, and Bounden. They're all games that like really depend on your physical interaction with other people in an interesting way, either just literally how your hands intertwine or moving in the style of a ballet dancer to keep the balance of a kind of rotating ball on the iPhone, or one of my favorites, like Friendstrap, where you just have to keep your thumb on it while you talk about these topics that it keeps bringing up, and it goes on for hours. So like being attached to someone for hours is an interesting physical experience. Next slide, because I'll go a little quicker than I thought. I also want to really emphasize that all this talk about like these physical games and movement games, does somatics is not only about what it's like to be in a fully like perfectly functioning human body. It's not about normalcy, either physical, or it's not about even about neurotypical normalcy either. So we can design these practices, our games, to actually allow for a wide participation of people that have different physical or neurological influences. And I think one really good hint that I got when I was talking to Bernie before this, I was asking what he thought about this. And aside from like creating variations for your games to have for different people, and also encouraging more improvisational types of play, his tip was to always have an opportunity to opt out of any experience that you design in case someone tries it and it's not for them and they want to get out. And then, in fact, really let people practice quitting your game. So if you're running a game in some kind of event-based session, have a way to like let people require, in fact, like make everyone that's playing practice quitting the game before they want to or before it's done, to sort of just exercise those quitting muscles so that if they ever need to have them in another future game, they can use those. I want to tell a little bit about this slide. But the next one is going to be you guys, so get ready. This is a piece called the Verlustbüro, and it was created for a playful architecture competition. You can't see the whole thing, but it's like a maze of these dangling strips. And at one point, it was made in the middle of a city, and this woman on the left came by and was really interested to see what was going on and wasn't sure she could participate. But because the project was made with people that were training to be professional architects, they'd built everything a kind of to code, even though it was on the grass. So the whole thing was really easy for her to go through and ride, like get her chair into the game and actually take part in it. And that was like one of the more eye-opening and important like experiences for me as a designer, to see how that was, so it was so powerful to enable that. Okay. So one other practice that I was interested in lately and kind of wanted to show and talk about the playful aspects of it is acro yoga. And I actually was able to convince some wonderful people from the Antwerp acro yoga group to come over and do a little demonstration for us. So I hope everybody can see. Yay. This is, go ahead. So this is Ellen and Katrine. So what acro yoga is, if you haven't heard of it before, is it's like a combination of acrobatics and yoga, kind of like a Thai massage style yoga, Thai yoga, that involves a lot of like a person like pulling and pushing on your limbs. And as you can see, like it combines like play and balance and technique and skill. And even like therapy, there's like some therapeutic motions that you can do to help people like stretch out and stuff like that. And there's actually three roles. They're really good. So normally there'd be a third person who's a spotter, and that would be like, I'm going to spot you. Good. I'm going to pretend I'm spotting you, but you don't even need it. But if I was, I'd be like this in case, she loses her balance or something like that. And you have to be very attentive to the person. And those three roles are considered the like kind of core of the practice. So I think one of the things that really intrigued me the most about acro yoga is there's a lot to do with like the communication. Like the moves are a little tricky, but there are things that you can do that you would never expect you could do. That like, for instance, I can't do it because I'm talking to you right now, but there are a few things that I've done that I'm like, how the hell did I even do that? But it's because you have so much like communication with the people that you're playing with. And in fact, one thing that I noted early on is that when acro yoga people are wanting to invite each other to come participate, it's always called playing. Who wants to come play in the park today? And they mean come and do acro yoga. So the types of communication that you can have are obviously like verbal. You can ask like, is that pressure okay? Or is that too much weight? Do you want to readjust where your position is? But there's also like nonverbal communication. Like, is that person like holding their breath? Are they really tense? What are their facial expressions? Are they like squishing up their face? Or how does their body react? Are they like tensing up their muscles in a certain way? You have to like, as the other people, both people have to pay attention to what the other person is saying, not just through words. And then also there's techniques of actual touch, like if you're holding someone's arm or leg in a grip, you can actually communicate or signal through squeezing or other things like that. And now I'll just let them finish. Awesome, I get to watch now. Yay! And I want to let you know that if you're interested in acro yoga from that, you can go chat with them after, and there's a Facebook group that's Antwerp Acro Yoga, so you can look that up. I hope I have like a few more minutes. I wanted to talk about the project that I'm working on right now with Phoenix Perry. I might skip the video. That might be my way to like buy the time. So I'm not going to show you the amazing Smithsonian video of that is like the sort of theoretical basis for the project we're working on. But it's about bees and how they communicate with each other through their senses. And not really their sense of sight, but through motion and doing a small dance that the other bees can then gather around and like they're basically touching the bee that's dancing and figuring out what they're saying. It's always they're always saying the same thing. It's like the pollen or the nectar is over there. It's that far away relative. It's that far away and it's at that angle relative to the sun comparatively to the vertical. So that they have like a just basically little. You know, geometric equation that they communicate through their dance. So I'm not going to show the video, but it's a really cool one. You can look it up on, you know, YouTube. So next slide, not the black one, but the next one. So right now, some of these pictures were taken a while ago, but I have some from literally an hour ago where we're over in a fab lab. It's called Faber, but it's a fab space. So we're working on this game that is going to include haptic sensations. So it's using vibrators. It has 28 vibrations built into a bunch of panels, and then the rings around the outside are going to be the sort of pollen that you can collect if you can identify the way that the bee, the invisible virtual bee, is dancing. Maybe go to the next slide and we can have a look. Yeah, so there's like it in literally in construction. Yeah, Makerspace, Faber Makerspace have been really awesome to us, so I want to make sure they get a shout out. We really want to explore entirely like different kinds of engagement and movements that people might do. We're requiring that everybody is like taking their shoes off. We don't want people like just walking over this. It's more like, are they going to get down and touch it, and how are they going to figure out what the pattern is by their sense of touch, and how will people use their body to play with it. And then maybe after that, what can we even, after we have this literal platform built, what can we do with that to enable more sensory or haptic types of play? And like working in this more sculptural form. I really want to get people out of like just standing upright when they're interacting and see what happens when people crawl around, basically. That's basically it. I want to like it, you know, all of this is not about like just going past your comfort zone for thrills. It's much more about like everyone being able to expand what their comfort zone is. And I think that we game designers have tools to make that happen. And we have this like concept of the magic circle as our context, and we can use it to create physical spaces and mental space for people to relate in a different way to themselves and to other people. And I think our world could probably use a little bit of that kind of connection right now.
Thanks. Thank you so much. I thought that was super interesting, not least because Boal is a really big influence on my own practice.
What has?
Boal, Augusto Boal.
Oh, yeah.
Because I come from a theater background.
Okay.
So obviously embodied practice is like super mm-hmm. interesting to me. Take a seat. We're going to do 5 minutes of questions before we listen to Kate Gray's talk. I'm so sorry.
Yeah, there you go.
Notice I was killing your yoga mat. I'm really sorry. Really interesting to hear it expressed as somatics as well. Mm-hmm. And again, I'm super supportive of the idea that the mind-body split mm-hmm. is really counterproductive, particularly like politically at the moment. It feels yeah. like admitting that we are time-limited flesh sacks that... move and exist and breathe.
That's how I like to think of myself, beat. Definitely, as a time-limited right? flesh sack.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That just came out of my mouth. I don't even know what's happening. But yeah, I think that it was super nice to hear about how your embodied practice then reinforms your work with electronics and video games.
Yeah.
So I would like to open the floor up to a couple of questions for Heather. Who has a question? Raise your hand. Yeah? Sure. So I have to repeat the question for the recording. So this gentleman here asked about the relationship between ritual and games, and if you could elaborate more on that.
Mm-hmm. And how that informs my design. Yeah. This is the first one I think I've actively thought about that connection, and so I think I will be exploring that more in the piece here, because it is so physical, and therefore, and it's going to be, it's very brightly lit here, but I think the whole idea is that it'll be much darker and that there'll be a kind of glowing sense to it. And I want to structure the interaction so that it starts to feel maybe repetitive or a little bit ritualistic, to maybe just get into a kind of different headspace with that. But I'm sure I'm not the first person that has ever thought about this connection between ritual and games. To me, it's because there is this emphasis on controlled behaviors, but having those small behaviors being incredibly symbolically significant. So that's part of what it is for me. And just the idea that ritual also kind of conjures something into being, and games are also very capable of that. I can't say I've pursued all this super far yet, but it's something I want to work more on.
If it is a thing that you're interested in, there's a book by Richard Schechner from the 70s and a certain era of performance art, which really looked into all of society as play and ritual as a part of that and games as a part of that. And it's really interesting, although super problematic in certain ways, because Richard Schechner was a white guy in 1970s America, so he just sort of elides a lot of consent questions. When he experiments with performance art and bodies in space, that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
Any more questions? Let's have at least one more, because this is really interesting to me.
Well, then you can ask one.
What do you want?
Okay.
No,
okay. Asked. Okay.
Too many questions. That was my problem.
Okay.
How do I narrow it down? I'd love to hear more about what your relationship to practicing consent, practicing no, practicing opting out, and these kinds of ideas.
So I'm just going to repeat their question again for the recording. So that was around consent. Could you talk some more about that idea of practicing no and practicing quitting the game?
Mm-hmm. When Bernie DeKoven was chatting with me and explained that, I was just a light bulb went off, because it was such a good idea that that we have this maybe inhibition or feeling of shame if we want to quit something, and that having this practice that everyone is required at least once, even the ones who would never think of potentially feeling uncomfortable, that it's kind of a show of solidarity as well. It's everyone might theoretically at some point need to opt out of this, and so having an actual exercise where you make quitting into a game itself seemed to me to be a really clever way, a healthy way to handle that. I haven't actually thought about that in other parts of my practice. It was something that came up more because it's so physical based, and I knew that there would be people with different abilities that wanted to play or were looking for a way to participate, and how could I make that more in my practice than I have in the past.
There's a related idea in a few RPG circles that I know, where they have the X card. I don't know if you've seen
I don't know
that.
About this.
I think it's free to download, the little explanatory pack, which is super, super good, that accompanies the X card. But it's the idea that you're doing an RPG, and at any point, if someone brings up a subject or an idea or a character that you're just not comfortable with, you can play the X card. You don't have to explain it. It just goes, no thank you to that thing that we've made up, because it makes me feel something that I don't want to feel, which I think is a really nice mechanic to add into any kind of the collaborative games practice.
Mm-hmm.
And
yeah.
I think those rooms to just go, it's okay, but no, I think is really important. Any more questions? I think we've got room for one more question before, because we are running late because of technical things, so I do want to give you the time that you've been allocated. Yes.
I'm interested in that feeling of pushing boundaries and doing things that make you deliberately uncomfortable and allowing that to be the player's choice, or are you putting thoughts on that?
Okay, so that's thoughts on that feeling of pushing boundaries and that being the player's choice. Could you elaborate more?
Well, what immediately comes to mind is what happened to me when I was playing The Fever, which was that theatrical piece. This is more an anecdote. I don't know if it's like a real overview, but it informs my feelings about it a lot. And that is that I'm kind of stage shy. Like, I think of myself that way anyway. And I was at this performance intentionally not knowing, I had not read any reviews, I didn't know it was gonna go on. And the very first time someone that was an actor, spoke up and asked something of one of the members of the audience, I mean, it was in a rather large circle, square, so when they looked across the room, there was a range of people they might be looking at, but the first time someone asked a person in the audience to, like, get up and perform an action, it really felt like they were looking at me, and there was that, like, that moment that felt like an eternity where I was like, is it me? I don't know, is it me? And then right at the end of that, the woman next to me stood up. And I still don't know if it doesn't even matter in a way, like one of us had to do it, and there's that, like, space of time that I was terrified. I didn't know what was going to happen, and she stood up. As the production went on, the ways that they would ask people to participate were maybe a little less singling them out and a little more like multiple people could do something. And I started getting up and volunteering to do stuff. And then by the end of the performance, there was a moment when there was one other non-actor, like just audience member on stage. And it also, the amazing thing was how things would just start happening kind of in flow without nobody in the audience being like instructed to do it. I mean, yes, they were instructed by that person at that moment, but there was never any mandate, that somebody had to do a thing, but always someone, and usually quite a different someone, would participate. So at the end, there was this other woman standing on the stage, and everyone else had returned to their seats after kind of a big group scene, and they were describing, it was actually, the piece was a lot about community, and they were describing this woman, she was like standing in front of the window over the sink and was looking out, and suddenly she saw across the yard that there was someone standing there. And the woman was, like, right across, like, very far away, but looking pretty much directly in my direction. And I remember, like, that other eternity of, like, who is going to be this person that, like, stands up? And it's, like, clearly getting toward the end of this thing. Maybe it's the finale. I don't know. Like, a million things is going through, I'm sure, everyone's heads. And finally, I was like, screw it, it's me. And I, like, stood up. It's like, obviously, it's me. And it was just, and then there was like a scene that lasted like 2 minutes or so where we were like just looking at each other and breathing and I just like got this weird sense of like total calm, even though I was like excited, and I was like, wow, I am really doing something here that at the beginning of this production, I would not have been capable of doing. And they gently, through this play, brought me to the point where I could not only do that, but I was like super glad to be doing that and was like grateful that I had been brought to that place. And so I think that for me is like what I would want to do. I don't think it's like about violating someone's boundaries. It's just more about like enticing people to broaden them.
Beautiful. Thank you so much for your talk and your answers, and let's all join in a big round of applause for Heather. Thank you.
Thank you.
And mute your mic. Okay, so we're going to have a